All right.
Now,
hey!
Oh,
I think I did it.
Go check your, like, right, have you checked your YouTube feed?
I'm going to check it right
check
now.
Your,
I
check
I,
it right now.
I think this worked,
you just
guys.
Watch link.
I'll show you guys what I'm doing this, so just make sure this works. I go to my watch link. This is my live events. I'm just going to do this one. I'm going to go YouTube.
Steve.
Yes, is that Evan?
Yes.
What's up, buddy?
Hey. You're live already on YouTube.
Yeah, that's
awesome. Yeah. I want to see if the live chat works, though.
Yes, you're live right now.
And let me get that page so I can actually watch the chat. Actually, I can do it from my live feed, can I?
What you need to do is go to your YouTube page and find your live feed, right? Admins put it in for you. So go to that. And you should now see this hangout running live.
That's the YouTube, like, live YouTube right now.
Yeah.
Okay, this is it right here. All right, so here we go. The chat, yeah. Yay, chat's working.
Live chat is working.
Yeah.
And by the way, to let you know, Steve, that is approximately 1 minute behind in anything we say. So that means if you're wanting to talk to somebody outside, you got to say it and then wait a minute for them to actually respond. And I mean 60 seconds. I don't mean, like,
okay.
Give it a minute.
So the time delay on when you're using the live chat, the time delay is longer. It's a minute.
No. Whenever they type something, it's immediate. But whenever we're speaking right now, it'll take 1 minute video feed to get from us to them.
But how does that differ from the normal hangout?
It doesn't.
Okay, I got you.
So in other words, if we type something in the chat out there, it'll appear immediately. But if we say something in here, it'll be 60 seconds before they can actually hear what we're saying.
This is my Facebook page. I mean, everybody knows who I am. So, I mean, there's no docking myself because this is me. I used to write these little e-cards like this. God loves all his children, but did he tell you that you were adopted?
Yeah.
I wrote that.
Yes, you did.
I have tons of memes that if you go to my photos. By the way, I do know hot chicks, by the way. You guys want to see some hot, yeah.
By the way, Steve, yes, he did tell me I was adopted. So what's your point?
But I try to find my cards. Anyways, if you want to go to my page and look at my e-cards like this that I wrote tons of them, and they're quite funny and entertaining. This is not my real sister, by the way, but she loves me.
If you know how to do it, you could be like Nadia Chambers and put everything down in the description on your contact information, whether it be Skype, Twitter, Instagram, whatever it is. You can put it in the description before you start the video, so as soon as you start the video, it'll automatically be down there.
I gotcha. It's a good idea.
Which, I did that for my dad for the longest time. If you ever go look at his channel, like, I did all of that work for him.
Yeah, that's a good idea. Obviously, people are finding it. I've gotten some viewers, so, I mean, they're transferring over from the previous Hangout. Not to get into great detail about it, but since I've got you here, admin, I mean, what do you think of this kind of situation where I know people have the pluses and minuses with you. Either one of those people like you and they don't. I've never had an issue with you, so I get along with you just fine. I think you're pretty cool to talk to. What do you think of somebody being accused of their position, though? When Netflix Free calls me an atheist when I'm not an atheist, how do you respond to that, if I can get your opinion on it? Because you're big in this. In their theological communities, because you're a theist.
Well, if they choose to think someone's an atheist, then that's their opinion. But that won't change the fact of what they are. No matter what happens, the only way it would change it is if they come out and say they're a theist or they're an atheist.
Right, that's an opinion.
It all depends.
But he's not saying in his opinion I'm an atheist. He's saying I'm an atheist.
Like, for instance, if Nephilim states to you that you're an atheist and you outright state I'm not an atheist, then that would just mean that obviously he has something that would be, he wouldn't quite know the full aspect behind why you say you're not an atheist, so he can't really make that claim. But by the same token, if you have reason to state why you're not a theist, then that would only give him one explanation. That would be you're an atheist, because there's a reason why it's called an atheist, and there's a reason why it's called a theist. So there you go.
Yeah, see, but he wants to play word games with that. I'm atheistic towards something, some deities, but I might be theistic toward another. I believe there probably is, or high probability in my opinion, I think there might be something more out there. I've always tended to think that, based on my own personal subjective opinion, my own personal experiences, that there probably is something out there that would be a deistic type being. The nuances of it.
I would make you a deist, sir.
Right, but I understand that, but well, more theist, because a deist doesn't accept that God interacts with people. I would be a theistic evolutionist if that was the case, but that definitely does not make me an atheist, right?
No, it makes you a deist.
Okay, you said. Okay, describe your definition of deist again.
A deist would be that God's everything in motion, but doesn't really interact with mankind.
That would be correct. Yes.
Sounds valid to me.
That would be an actual theist. But the only reason why they call it a deist is because they do believe that there is somebody. It's just they're not intervening in any way, shape, or form. Unlike a theist would be someone that believes that is still here and still presently doing things for them. That's the only difference. So if you just so happen to state that Nephilim calls you an atheist, that would not be a correct assumption, but that is his personal belief. So that's all I would have to say about that.
Let me post this in here real quick. I'm not screen sharing anymore, am I right? If that matters.
No, you're not.
Okay. So, I mean, but based on what I've told you, I mean, if I specifically say that I'm not an atheist, and yet all his videos talks about me being an atheist, and he keeps on telling people I'm an atheist, I think that's dishonest.
If you put off a conclusion, kind of like if I put off a conclusion as though I'm an atheist, and I claim to be a Christian or a theist for that matter, then most of the time people are going to go with your actions than go with what you're trying to state in the background, if you get what I'm saying. Because anybody can claim to someone's face that they're one thing and then go behind their back and do another. But it takes somebody to be legitimate to go check their background and hear them out and try to see whether or not they're being truthful and honest to the words. So whenever you state that you're not an atheist, and then let me ask you, have you made videos saying you're an atheist?
Never. I've never enunciated those things in my entire life.
So in other words, that would be the statement where you would have to make a video stating that I am not an atheist, I am a deist. The difference being an atheist states that there's no proof or no evidence to come to the conclusion that there is such a thing as a God, whereas a deist believes that there can be such a thing as a God. It's just he stepped away. If there is such a thing as a higher power, he stepped away from his creation that he created.
Yes, I don't believe that either, though. I think he is involved. If he exists, he's involved. So I wouldn't be a deist. I would more be a theist.
Therefore, you would be a theist.
But again, I don't subscribe. This is my actual position. I'm a theological non-cognitive for a reason, and I'm an apatheist. Because when I'm online, okay, I am not a person to engage in the religious conversations. It's not my thing. I don't have a dog in that fight. I want to keep it to what's demonstrable, what is evidential, and what the science, okay? And I think when we get down this rabbit hole and we start violating the first falsehood of creation, first foundational falsehood of creationism that Aaron Ra has, that that people equate like evolution to atheism, I don't want to go down that route. I want to talk about the science. So I just say I'm apathetic. I'm an apatheist. I'm an agnostic as well. But I'm a theological non-cognitive because when we're talking about certain gods, what God are you talking about? If you tell me that the God that you believe in created the world and that the earth is only 7,000 years old, which I do know you hold that belief, yeah, of course, I'm not going to believe in that deity. I would be atheist toward that deity, and I have said that numerous times. But that does not make me an atheist. It just makes me an atheist on that one position, that one claim.
Okay, can you remake that last statement you said because I was walking in my house?
I was saying that if you tell me that your God is created the earth and the earth is only 7,000 years old, then yes, I will be atheistic toward that claim, that to that God, that single positional claim. Then yes, I'm atheist toward that. But that does not hold. That does not mean I'm atheist. It does not mean I'm atheist toward any other position or any other deistic thing. That's why I'm called theological non-cognitive or agnostic, because I don't think the term God is really easily defined in those things. Does that make sense?
Correct. I mean, I can understand where you're going with that. That wouldn't necessarily make you an atheist.
Correct.
Or a theist. That would just instate that you have your opinion upon how the creation was. That does not determine whether or not you're an atheist or a theist or a deist or anything else. That just means that you have your own opinion upon the topic of how creation and all the how actual creation happened. That's all that means.
Absolutely, and that sums it up pretty well. I will accept that. I like that. So I think everybody can agree though that Nephilim Tree is lying.
He's not lying. He's at least very, very wrong.
Okay.
I would say he's.
I'll take that.
Upon this topic, I wouldn't state that he would be wrong. Now, let me tell you why. He would be severely mistaken. It's not wrong for someone to have an opinion about something that could be wrong. It's just he has a he apparently is misinformed in the information that he thought was one thing, but until it's been brought to the forefront, he does not actually know something, so he cannot think it's wrong.
You can't run behind opinion on this one. This is a statement of Steve's identity, what he believes. It's either true or it's not. It's not a matter of opinion here.
What I'm stating is, unless Nephilim has heard out of Steve's mouth direct words, I am not a theist or I am not an atheist. He can only base his conclusion based upon his videos and what he has seen him do, but he cannot come to a objective opinion until he speaks directly to Steve.
Right. But here's the problem, Evan. I was in many hangouts with Nephilim Free. Many, 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 many hangouts. And we even talked about this specifically because one hangout that we were in, I'm getting music. Who is that?
What?
Do you guys ever hear music in the background?
A little bit.
I do.
I know what that is. I think that's actually Colby's toy here.
Okay. Yeah. McDonald had a farm. Anyways, we were in a video where Nephilim made the claim that atheists have to hold to ontological naturalism. And I explained to him, no, atheists just lack a belief in a God. It has no claim on their ontology as far as there being a supernatural thing out there, like a ghost or whatever. It has you can have atheistic people that believe in supernatural. He said no. And I explained to him at the time, I'm not an atheist, but I'm explaining to the atheist position. I've said this numerous times to him. You know, he's not unaware of this, and if he has a short-term memory, that's not my problem. But in that video, he makes a point of it to call me an atheist.
Well, then that means he'd be severely misled. That's what that would mean. He wouldn't be wrong because he doesn't understand the magnitude of being wrong. Unless you know what's right and what's wrong in the scenario, you can't say someone's wrong or right.
So you're saying Nephilim is not cognizant enough to know that he's just saying a falsehood?
What I'm stating is he is severely apparently mistaken, because if he thinks that someone is an atheist when they have outright stated that I'm not an atheist, then apparently he, without being quite blunt with it, without throwing Nephilim under the bus, stating the simple fact of he apparently has forgotten the definition of an atheist.
Hmm. Well, I do agree that people can define it different ways. I have principle of charity, and so I'm like, if someone wants to call themselves an atheist and they mean a lacktheist, or they actually assert that God doesn't exist, it's all how they want to use the term. It's up for discussion on what the terms actually mean. But I go by positions, and positional-wise, I don't say that there is no God. That means I'm not an atheist.
Okay, Fiona put something in the side chat. Fiona, do you mind actually stating what you stated in the side chat, please?
Yeah. So if we're saying, that somebody is they're not aware of what somebody stated their position to be and they get it wrong and that's a mistake. But what when someone has stated their position again and again and again and again and yet they are still misrepresented?
Okay, well, first off, allow me to... I know exactly where this would be going because I remember the whole entire drama 6 months ago of you and G-Man and Shanny for Christ and all that. I remember that whole entire drama. Allow me to make sure I word this very clearly for anyone that may be listening, as well as the people in the room. when you call yourself, okay, first off, I'm not, quote-unquote, a Christian. I'm a believer, okay? There's a major line there because I don't like being told that I'm a Christian when I'm not. Now, when you call yourself a Christian, you have to distinguish what you mean by Christian. There is a thing called Christians. I know Deidre is going to have fun with this when I say this, but there's such thing as Catholics, then there's such thing as Presbyterians, and all these other nice little labels that go along with Christian that people claim when they say Christian, they don't actually mean Christian. They mean like Presbyterian, they mean Catholic and all that, when that's not a Christian. A Christian would be what the Bible describes a Christian to be, which would be a follower, which would be a believer, which seeks after his knowledge, which does not agree with what the Catholic Church states of infant baptism. That the Bible does not say anywhere in the Bible does it say you have to baptize a baby in order for them to be saved. No, it does not say you have to go to the Pope and confess it. It says pray and confess it. There's many things in the Catholic Church that differs from the Christian Church. So when you say that you're a Christian, that does not mean Catholic. That means Christian. So that summons that whole thing up in one shot. Fiona, do you have any questions about that?
Yeah, because what I would see is that if you state that you accept that Christ is God made flesh, and you believe that completely, and you accept that he came down here and that he was crucified and he died so that our sins are forgiven, and that by grace alone we are forgiven. Grace alone.
Then what the hell was up with Mother Teresa?
Let me finish. And that after he died, on the third day, he rose again. And he ascended into heaven. And he will be coming again. When you affirm all of that as your core beliefs, that's your core beliefs.
That would be the core beliefs, the core beliefs of a Christian, whereas whenever you're saying that that's what you believe, and then you turn right around and you do something different where other people can see that you're doing something different, then people are going to more look at you from what you're doing than what you have been doing versus what you are doing, if that makes sense.
Well, no, it doesn't actually, really, because I've just described the basic core beliefs, and there was no doing there at all. There was just the what you actually hold as a belief. That you believe absolutely.
I can have a soul belief right now in which that I am going to go into the nearest town after this hangout, go into the nearest town and go hang out with one of my friends for 4 hours. But if I'm sitting here in a hangout and then I leave this hangout, instead of me going to hang out with my friend, if I go and join an audience hangout, that would be evidence to prove that that's not exactly what I had believed. Okay, I could believe one thing, but I could be doing another.
Right, so what would you need to be doing to show that you did not believe that your salvation has come through grace alone by the sacrifice of Christ?
Okay, repeat that question again, because if I'm not mistaken, that question was rather easy to answer, but I'm trying to make sure I get this right.
Yeah, okay. So what I'm saying is, what would you need to be doing to show that you don't really hold the belief that your salvation is by grace alone and that it comes to you because of the sacrifice of Christ?
Okay. Well, first off, you're going on a premise in which could not be taken on itself alone, because what you're stating is, how can you bring a representation of that it's by grace and grace alone, when if you're going to be basing something upon grace and grace alone and you're not willing to show the fruits of the Spirit, as the Bible says, you'll know them by their fruits. If you're not willing to show the fruits of being the Christian kind, not going, although I'm a definite two-sided individual when I'm stating this right now, and I'm going to be the first one to admit it, going and hanging out in an atheistic crowd, to a deist crowd, to an agnostic crowd, to whatever crowd you want to call yourselves, although it would be a double standard of me doing this, but I'm doing this only because I'm obviously a waste of time and I'm not calling myself a Christian. That would not be the thing to do. What you would do is you would go into Christian hangouts. Hold on. What you do is you go into Christian hangouts and you would talk to Christians and you would basically entwine with more Christians if that's what you believe, because that would be your core belief. If your core belief is Christianity, then obviously you don't go around atheist, you go around Christians. If you're an atheist, you go around atheist. It's simple.
No, because, and I'll tell you something else, it has only recently come to my attention that even on an issue in which the radical evangelicals agreed with me, they were still telling others to shun me. Okay. Why would I... Okay. Why? Let me finish. Let me finish. Why would I want to go into hangouts with people who have spread rumors that I've committed adultery?
Okay.
And then admitted that it isn't true and they only said it for a joke. Why would I want to hang around with someone who's done that?
Do you want me to tell you? Here we go. It's simple words in less than 10 seconds. Are you ready? Because all you have to do is walk in there and tell them, this is what I believe, and I'm going to show you by coming in and being honest and being generous. That's what I would do.
And while we're at it, how do you if who you hang around is what you are, then how do you explain missionaries?
Well, first off, missionaries, allow me to explain that. Because missionaries are called to go into that field, whereas some believers have their own hometown to deal with, because it doesn't just say go out and preach across the sea. It says do what you are called to do. If you're called to be a, I will give you a prime example. Me, I'm called to be an evangelist, okay? So this is kind of an evangelistic work for me. So technically I'm not against going anything with God say for me to do. But I'm a song leader at my church as well as a sound man. God called me to those fields. So that means if God calls you to a certain field, then that's where your objective is It's not... Okay, well, if that's the case and you can't hang out with people, then why do missionaries do it? Because God called them to do it.
Well, what you said, though, is who you hang out with predominantly is what you are. So if I'm a Christian missionary who gets sent to proselytize in a primarily Taoist country, by your definition, I'm a Taoist.
No, but that's why I stated, if God calls you into that crowd, then... That's what God wants you to do.
How do you know Fiona's not being called to hang out with the atheists?
Yeah, you know, like you're supposed to do.
Hold on. Let me answer your question there. What's your name again? You're the atheist. Okay. Let me answer your question, the atheist. First off, I don't know, and I'm not presuming to know. That's why I stated, if just so happenstance that the whole entire rumors of 6 months ago were true, then that would be the case. But if they weren't, well, then I don't know. I can't tell Fiona, and it doesn't matter how much I tell her or I know, because I don't know. I don't know what God's plan is for Fiona, so that's why I state what I state. So I can't tell Fiona, you're not supposed to be hanging out with the atheist. Go ahead.
You kind of did, Adam. Let me ask you. Yeah, I think
that's the point I'm trying to make.
Actually, I did not say, Fiona, you should not be doing this. I said, if I'm... what I stated, if I'm not mistaken, and I'll try to quote this the closest I can without being long-winded in less than 10 seconds once again, I stated in a nutshell, if I'm called into that field, then that's what I would do. But before I said that, I also stated that if I'm claiming one belief, then that means I have to stick with that one belief. I'm not saying that it's wrong to go out of that equation and stick with that equation, because I don't know whether or not you're called into that field. So go ahead, Steve.
Okay.
So you're getting frustrated.
My eyes are a little burning a little bit. I hear what you're saying, but let me ask you this. I mean, do you think there's any advantageous purpose when you have like the atheist Brony and Wolf, who are definitely say they're atheists. So when they are exposed to people that espouse to be Christian, you know, Fiona and the Holy Spackle, I'll throw in Christian Anarchist, General Han Solo. These people are very articulate, very intelligent. They like science. They like to engage in these topics. When they look at them, that's what they think of as a positive aspect of Christianity. These people are positive people. If this is their exposure to Christianity, coming from these positive people like that, don't you think that's a good thing? I mean, their experience with Christianity so far, for the most part, from what I understand, for the G-plus community, has basically been like with G-Man and Nephilim. I'm sorry, they're not great representations of. I know you're talking. I'm saying Christianity. I should say deism, I guess, because you pointed out the difference. But they're not great representations of a theistic or deistic type position. So what is wrong with Fiona and other people that believe in a deity to come in and act as a representative, an example of what a decent Christian human being should be?
Well, that's a very simple answer. Summed it up in less than 15 seconds, and now you can put it on a timer. Well, first off, I'm going to be quite literal when I say this and abrupt. Some theists have not learned the definition to people that have changed and or they have not fully matured.
Yeah, and I agree with you. But it's funny. I mean, I don't think Fiona would have any problem going on a Christian anarchist show or hanging out with his Talking Theology Tuesday. Would you, Fiona? I know how I will, because he was on Coffee and Tea the other day, because Christian Anarchist asked me to be a guest on his TV show, or his broadcast, and honestly, I would have made a good guest. I don't really get into politics and all this other stuff, so I just said politely declined, and I was flattered, I was honored, but General was on there.
I gotta say though, when you say that, you know, if you're a Christian, then you should try to hang out with Christians more often. To me, all that sounds like is you're just trying to build an echo chamber or a bubble that, you know, protects yourself from outside opinions. If you actually go around and talk to people who disagree on a regular basis, that keeps you on your toes as far as the ability to think and argue for your case, or exposes you to other arguments you had never considered before. I'm a pretty hardcore liberal, but I used to go post on the GOP website all the time until they banned me, but oh well.
That's a good point. I mean, you do get exposed to other things. I mean, Avin knows most of my channel is dedicated to trying to debunk young earth creationism. That's not even saying, well, you don't debunk your creationism. Young earth creationism is already debunked. It's just people want to come in and try to give an argument for it or just, you know, something towards.
And yet you have fun with saying that, Steve. You
know. I know. Did I? You got that, right? That was good. I got that in there on purpose. Say it that way.
I'm not going there.
But anyways.
I've got another hypothetical question, if you don't mind.
Sure. I just like to say I like communicating with people that don't agree with me. You know, if everybody agreed with me, I would be bored off my ass, dude.
Well, I disagree with you about young earth creationism, but that's fine. I'll blow it out of your butt.
So, right. So here's the next question. Then it's hypothetical. So in that case, if you say that someone who is really a Christian shouldn't hang about with atheists, what do you suggest that a married couple should do when one is a Christian and one is an atheist?
Divorce.
Well, that is a question in which I literally was walking through the question not less than 2 months ago. I can tell you that firsthand.
That was a thing that I was told by a theist who found out that my wife is still theoretically a believer, and I am most decidedly not.
Well, my two cents is they should remain married.
See, what I'm going to give my two cents where it may add in there, okay? It's quite simple. It's called you show your testimony, and when I say show it, I don't mean obviously like a placard. I mean like you live your life accordingly. Let's just say you're the believer. You live your life according to what the scripture says. If you're the atheist, well, I don't know what to tell you because I'm not an atheist.
So you can sleep with an atheist, but you can't hang with them and hang out.
I didn't state that.
I'm cool with that.
Hey, Steve, can you like clarify? Did I ever say that you cannot hang out with him. I said, and I quote, you show your testimony, not in regards of a scrapbook or anything else. I said, you show your testimony by basically listening to what the Bible says, and you perform what the Bible says, etc. You follow what the Bible says.
Yeah.
But that doesn't say you can't hang out with them.
I want to clarify.
That's what you said, though. That's what you said to me.
Fiona, I never stated that you can't hang out with them.
Well, let me ask you this.
If that's the case, Fiona, make sure you go get a timestamp from that. Bring it back here so I can make sure I clarify it even more.
Well, let's clarify. Are you against Fiona hanging out like in one of the pandemoniums, hangouts?
I'm not against Fiona doing anything she doesn't want to do because she's her own person, and in the end, she's going to be the one held responsible for whatever she does.
But is that a bad thing? I mean, are you saying that she, in your opinion, should she be doing it? Not that.
I cannot tell you if what she is doing is right or what she is wrong, because then that would put me in what the book of Judges says, is judge not, lest ye be judged. And in the same manner that you judge, you shall be judged.
Hang on a second. Admin, are you a Christian or an atheist?
Steve, I feel like you now. I am neither.
Yeah. Welcome to my world there, buddy.
I am a believer in Christ.
Okay. So, are you saying that Fiona should not be hanging with atheists?
What I'm stating is she has the right to do whatever she wants to do, because in the end, she's accountable for her own actions.
And will she be judged for hanging with atheists?
She will be judged for whatever she may be doing or has been doing wrong, if she's done anything wrong, which I'm pretty sure she has, because for all have sinned. So, yeah.
So, Jesus...
Yeah, but you were actually judging my faith on that. That's the question I asked you. It was about my actual faith.
Steve,
remember?
This is a pointless discussion.
Okay, what were you saying, Fiona? I was touching your actual faith?
No, what I asked you, the question I asked you was, if somebody states that they're a Christian and they state what their core beliefs are, and then what do you say? And your answer
was, is it just me or she believing?
She's robotic.
I'm about to say she like froze up on my screen.
I mean we could probably move on a little bit because I don't think I'm gonna be a little principle of charity while Fiona reloads because we can't hear her. I don't think Admin is actually specifically saying that it's wrong for her to do so, but I think he's kind of being a little wishy-washy on his opinion whether she should be or not. But you know, it is. I do agree with Admin on one aspect. It is what people do. It's up to them. I mean, you're not passing judgment on anybody. I get that, right?
I choose not to judge people, so therefore I can't tell people what they can and cannot do.
Thank you, Kevin. By the way,
Okay, Fiona's back.
Thank you, Kevin. By the way, Jade West, come on in. She's been trying to get in, I guess.
The question I had actually asked was, if you actually state the core Christian beliefs, and you say that is what I believe, You said that then you've got to show that you believe it. And when I asked you what you meant by that, you said, well, basically being in Christian hangouts, not atheist hangouts. So right there, you were actually making a judgment on somebody's faith based on who they hung about with. Were they really a Christian or not, based on who they hung about with? That was the answer you gave to my question.
No, what I was stating in that regards was, if somebody is claiming to be a Christian and they're hanging out with an atheistic crowd or an atheism crowd, then that would make the Christians or the theist look at the person and find out whether or not they were still a theist or whether or not they were aiming more towards falling into the atheistic crowd, because that's how you get people like Fiona, that G-Man made butt ton of videos about saying, you're falling into sin, blah, 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 because G-Man misunderstood what was happening. And then later, if you watch his videos, he went back and apologized to Fiona, apologized to Shani, because he realized what was happening.
So, G-Man hasn't apologized to me.
I don't have any problems with you, nor G-Man, okay? I have G-Man on
Skype. I'm just pointing out he hasn't apologized to me.
If G-Man doesn't apologize to you, well, then that's on either you or G-Man. I cannot say who is wrong and who is right. Only thing I can say is...
I'm going to put this out here right now, admin. I'm going to put this out, please.
I'm all but finished.
No, I want to say this right now because of what you just said there. No, this is really important. You said you don't know who is wrong and who is right. Here is exactly what happened. G-Man spread a rumor. He said that I had an affair with somebody, with Alex Botton. And he claimed to have video evidence of this. One week later, G-Man admitted he'd made that whole story up for a laugh.
Do you have proof?
He admit it's in it's go back check Talking Shit Tuesdays from a year ago in January.
That's not what I asked you. Proof of it?
Do I have proof that he made that accusation? Yes. He made it live on air Talking Shit Tuesdays.
If you have proof of it, then why don't you make a video of stating that, so that means you can remind him. Can you apologize for stating this?
I have done. Look,
she's done all this before numerous times.
She's spoken to him face to face and asked for an apology.
Yes. And he's admitted he made all this up for a laugh. He admitted that. He made it up for a laugh. He admitted live on air that none of it was true.
Well,
he's admitted that.
That you'd have to understand that G-Man has yet to reach the point of being like, oh, wow, I was wrong, so now I need to actually apologize. Apparently he hasn't matured
but he knows he
in
was
that
wrong.
Area.
He knows he made it up because he's admitted making it up. That's why when you said, I don't know who's right or who's wrong, I wanted to get in there.
When someone
because
G-Man's
admitted
they need
it.
To apologize.
Right, so that's why I then asked you, why would I want to hang about in a Christian hangout with someone who's done that to me?
Because maybe instead of you thinking that they're going to chew you out every time, maybe if you go into their hangouts and make it a regular thing to go into their hangouts whenever they have them, it might actually show that they're trying to change. Kind of like if you go into rehab and you keep going into rehab, that shows that you're actually trying to change versus going to the drug crowd every time.
Here's one thing you've missed.
Go ahead.
Sometimes we have to shake the dust from our feet, and that's what I've done.
Hold on, Steve. Sorry to cut you off again. But if that's the case, then why did you bring it up?
She didn't. You did. You're the one who brought up not hanging out with Christians.
Yeah. The atheist. I was talking to Fiona, I was talking to Steve about that topic. Then she brought that whole entire topic about Christian beliefs and who you should hang out with.
Right, but that's all an outgrowth of the original conversation.
Yeah,
the original conversation was in between me and Steve about that topic.
Yeah, but but it was tangentially related to something very specific to her, and she had a right to comment on that.
But then she commented on it, but she opened it even more into the question about her and her beliefs. So that had nothing to do with me other than me just stating my opinion about the topic.
But do you understand why Fiona doesn't go into those rooms and why?
No, I understand that. I don't tell her she should and she shouldn't. I just say that's my opinion.
No. I mean, but you're okay with hanging out with, like, I mean, you're in a room here with two atheists, three atheists, I'm sorry. Four atheists.
Seriously, what's the point of this discussion?
We're bored. I don't know how I got there.
But don't look at me. Don't look at me. I'm just here for the lulz.
Yeah, I'm not sure how I went down this route. I think we beat that horse to a bloody pulp.
Not only did we beat the horse to a bloody pulp, we dived down the rabbit hole that was under it, and we're still digging.
Well, I would like to bring up one more thing before we move on, but
we're digging and realizing the Earth is circle.
People can have like multiple interests and discuss different things with different groups of friends, and Fiona likes to talk of science a lot, which means true G-Man Nephilim are completely out of bounds when it comes to that kind of stuff. You can get a lot more conversation on scientific issues from generally the group here.
And I can tell you right now, if we have two strong people that believe very strongly in a deity, and that would be Fiona and General Han Solo, and I know you two, Ivan as well, but Fiona and General, both of them want to discuss it with the atheist Brony and Wolf, in an off-air hangout, just talking about religion I don't think any four of them would have an issue with that. I really don't think they would. Because they disagree with all that. They disagree with each other. But on other things, they agree wholeheartedly.
Thanks, Steve.
About what?
You threw me out of the category of...
Yeah, I did not. No, I just said... I included you in the category.
You pointed at Fiona and you pointed at the general.
I wanted to make it two-on-two. I wanted to make it fair, okay?
That wasn't fair. Life isn't fair, so I'll give
you that. Because you can take on nine atheists yourself, right? I mean, so that's...
No, see, what we're doing is we're setting up a match for WrestleMania, and you got to be the Christian manager.
I'm not a Christian, so it won't count.
Okay, you can't be the Christian wrestler because you're just a Christ believer, so you'll be the. That's why you're the manager.
I never said I was a Christ believer. Okay. I said I was a believer of Christ. There's a major difference.
If you say so.
So are you?
Oh, trust me, I've been down that rabbit hole. What'd you say, General?
Are you an omnism?
No.
My cat just bit my foot. Randomly wandered up.
Okay, we were tangential on that one.
It's because your cat heard me.
Here's the two orthogonal court conversations there.
The cat wants to join in this discussion.
Yeah, the cat wants to join in and talk to the general.
And that cat is about to get.
Don't say it on camera. Turn your mic off before you say it.
By the way, Steve, just a quick, like, way out of topic question. Even though we are out of topic, your previous hangout when you were making it on Nephilim Free. Mm-hmm. So, does he actually check out the recordings? Do you think? Like, would he take the time maybe tomorrow to look at that? You know, what you spoke about.
No fucking idea.
And hear your argument, or hear your...
Probably.
Like, I don't know if he...
No idea.
Do you think
he'll do it? No, well, about it? Sure. Yeah, no, he's in my circle, so, I mean, he sees my feed. Anytime I post something, it's open to anybody. He might watch the first few minutes of it, but Nephilim Free... I mean, he does his own thing, so I have no idea why. But we looked. I hope he does.
No, I was just wondering. I was just wondering if he would.
Oh, something going on in live chat.
Go ahead.
Because I mean, you're like spending, precious time, and it's good for edifying other people. But you know, these guys, they just won't change. You know,
No, I don't. I didn't do the response to Nephilim Free for Nephilim Free. I mean, it's just Nephilim Free. He can say whatever he wants, and nobody has to respond. I mean, it's just, his stance in the community is so low that nobody believes jack shit from him except his clown car posse. Except for maybe seven people in the entire fucking community still have any respect for Nephilim Free. I mean, he has no respect for the community. None. I mean, literally. This goes back years ago.
Are you sure about that?
Yeah, he's got very... I mean,
okay,
come on.
Okay, seven, you might want to say eight. Because I do somewhat agree with his stance, but I disagree with a large proportion of what he says.
So it goes from 7 to 7.5 then.
I see where you went with that.
Okay. I didn't have to, but I wanted to just for other people to know the situation because it was so blatantly wrong what he said.
Hey, Steve, can I do a lol moment?
Yeah. Yeah, go for it.
Okay, okay, that's kind of like 2.5 men. I'm the half when you said that scenario.
You're the half.
If you get it, 7.5.
It's just, Steve, like, I mean, I would be frustrated when no one, you know, when someone cowards out, like becomes a coward and just ignores what you have to say.
I'm curious, General.
And so I'm just hoping that you...
Finish your train of thought, you about coward what? That you think definitely be a coward if he doesn't respond.
No. So for example, if I was in your shoes, and if I took the time to, you know, speak out on what happened, and then if he doesn't say anything, like if Nephilim Free just ignores it, then but that's just me. It just gets on my nerves because it's like I wasted my time doing that. You know.
Not really. I'm just hoping that
I'll
link to his video later on in that video. You know when I. I don't care where he sees him. I'm sure he will. When people make these kind of videos, I get little messages. I have ears everywhere, and. I was mildly entertained by the fact that they felt the need to bring me up. And then G-Man's sitting there going, who's Steve McCrae? Come on, John General, how many times have I been in G-Man's hangouts?
Are you serious? G-Man's?
Yeah, he's like, who's Steve McCrae? I don't know. Maybe because he never heard my last name pronounced, and they didn't show a picture of me.
Oh, so okay.
I'm thinking that was the case, because I'm like, gee, man, don't sit there and tell people you don't know who I am. I've been in your hangouts a multitude of different times. You and me and Gus have been out. Gus Bellinger have gone at it many times in hangouts, so he can testify that I've been in many hangouts with you. I just think that he didn't recognize the last name, and I'm gonna be charitable here, and think that because not many people know how to pronounce my last name, which is McCrae. But
right.
You know, unless you hear it, he's probably not gonna put two and two together, and that's what I think happened. And of course, Trudeau's me as well. But
I'm curious, General, what religion are you, if any?
I'm an Corellian.
I think I'm gonna have to wiki that.
It's kind of like Klingon and Vulcan, but in a different quad sector. It's like the Gamma Quadrant.
Romulan. That's what you mean, yeah. Romulan. Okay.
No. I said Corellian.
Oh, Corellian.
Yeah, that was like the second season of Star Trek when Spock gets those little bat things that suck on his head and you know suck on his back.
It has nothing to do with Star Trek.
Okay, then I'm off.
Is that a little bit of Deep Space Nine-ish?
No.
That's not. It's
just
not the
just type in Corellia.
It's Star Wars. It's Star Wars right there.
Oh, okay, Star Wars. Is that like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, or 7?
That's Han Solo's background.
Okay, which
it's
one?
Actually, Corellia is actually a system in Star Wars, and the people from them were called from that system were called Corellians. Han Solo is one, and the Millennium Falcon was built by Corellians.
Well, see, I wasn't too far off. I was just in the wrong universe.
Yeah,
you were in the wrong
multiverse,
the wrong movie.
Your reference was a long, long time ago in a galaxy far, far away.
Yep.
Well, I tell you what.
That's the opening. That's the opening words of my Bible.
Well, I've got Admin here. I mean, Admin, do you maybe want one of these weekends? Do you want to come on and discuss Young Earth? I mean, like, just you and me, nobody else, and just kind of have a one-on-one, point by point, because I respect you. I like talking to you. I find you entertaining. I'm enjoyable. I don't agree with your positions, but I think you and I could probably have a really good conversation. I'm extending that to you if you ever decide that you want to, okay? Not with a panel, but just you and me.
Are you talking
Wait.
To me or Fiona?
Yeah, no, Adam, you.
Oh, I was trying to figure out because you were lagging there for a second when you said the name.
So, Admin, you're a young us.
Oh, man, you gave my position away. How dare you, Steve?
Actually, he's a non-Earther. He believes we live on Mars.
Yeah, I believe that I'm a non-Earther creation or an Eartherist. So that means I believe that there's no Mars. I believe we
were
born on
these,
Saturn.
What's
we
with these peculiar? What's with these peculiar like positions and ideologies? Like, is there a competition of finding the weirdest position possible?
No, it's a simple process of jerking one's chain.
General, that would be me, General. That would be me.
I'm a penism. This is my lord.
So. No. I'm not being mean because...
Well, don't
because Steve has a long... Steve has a long definition describing his position, and now yours is even, like... Yeah, even way... Steve's.
General, you thought that mine was a bad position? You should try hearing Wolf King.
Do you want to do that one day, Adam, though? I mean, if we get a chance?
That would all depend on what day and what I have doing for that day, because I don't plan things till like the next day, literally.
Right. Just something in the future, maybe, you know, if you know, get in like an hour.
But allow me to tell General here. My belief is I'm a non-Earther and Earther. That means I believe in which that there's no Earth. I believe that we were born on Venus, we were shipped to Pluto, and Saturn just so happened to land on top of Pluto, so we climbed on top of Saturn, and now we are on this thing called Saturn, the New Age Movement, which would be called Earth.
And that's very close to what Velikovsky probably would believe.
Exactly, that is. Yeah. But the exception of they don't believe that Saturn touched Pluto either, but we do.
Yeah. I know what you're referring to. Other people think you're kind of just making this shit up, but actually that actually is... a position somewhat very close to what's called Emmanuel Velikovsky's World in Collision. Worlds in Collision.
I know, that's why I said it.
But I mean, how you know about that is beyond me, because that's something that I read years ago, and unless you're my age or Fiona knows about it, I'm sure.
You don't think I do my research, Steve? Come on, man.
Yeah, no, that's cool. It's just weird that people actually know what that shit is. So it's kind of archaic, don't you think?
I know, right? I mean, I don't hear people ever talking about it, but rarely. I think that other than you and, like, Nephilim one time ever saying, I don't think anyone's ever even heard of that.
Yeah, I mean, he's not making this shit up, though. Yeah, well, you believe it or not, I know it's hard to believe, but I actually read a lot as a child and a teenager. A lot.
Not me. I read that back when I was like 8 years old. I'm well over 10 years over that. So
my favorite book.
I've expounded my beliefs based upon Pluto being so close. I couldn't help it when it disappeared, according to our recollection. If you go look it up nowadays, you literally can tell Pluto is not, according to us, a planet. So that means that it could not be true of the other religion. So that means my religion has to be true.
It's not a major planet. It's still a minor planet.
No. According to today, it supposedly still says it's not a planet.
No, it says it's not a major planet. It's called a minor planetoid.
Yeah, dwarf planet.
But my favorite book of all time, did you ever read this, A Stranger in a Strange Land by Robert Heinlein?
And the worst part about it is the sun, according to my belief, is not necessarily a physical sun. It's more of a hypothetical sun, and you hypothetically see things happening around you.
So it's a matrix sun.
Pretty much, yes.
Admin, did you ever read Stranger in a Strange Land by Heinlein?
I believe I have back when I was younger.
It's one of my all-time favorite books. Brilliant. I mean, God, that book is so good. I can't even describe it.
Is that why I wanted to forget it and burn it?
But there's a church that came out of it called the Church of All Worlds. And it's a legitimate church. It's a real church. And actually, it came from that science fiction books that they practice the Mars religion. For this guy that was the polarity of the story. Michael Vincent, Gene Michael Vincent, was that his name? Oh my God, what's his name? Michael Vincent.
Gino Michael Vincent.
Hey, Red just dropped into live chat.
Yes,
Red.
I've been putting a shout out to Red's debunk the other day. God, that was just so fucking good. I got wood. It was...
What about Gino Michael Vincent?
No, Valentine. Michael Valentine Smith was his name.
No, but there was a guy by the name of...
G. Michael Vincent. He was a helicopter pilot from... oh, what the hell is this show? Airwolf, wasn't it?
Yeah, no. It was something else.
You sure?
Yeah, I'm pretty sure. I would know it if I heard it, but that's not it.
So, God, I just got to add technology right at your fingertips again. I think of Jan Michael Vincent.
Has Rhett released the results of Mercury?
No, that's not going to happen until... That doesn't happen until May.
Okay.
From what I understand, the guy that Rhett was showing for 5 hours... By the way, Rhett, it's 5 fucking hours you were in this hangout. What the hell? I'm trying to explain to this guy. Anyways, he wants round two.
By the way, Steve, that would be Airwolf. Would be the name of the TV series.
Yeah, no, I said Airwolf. Jan Michael Vincent for Airwolf, yeah.
Jan Michael Vincent.
I need to go, guys.
Okay. Ta-ta. All right, thank you, Fiona. Appreciate it.
Thank you, Fiona.
Broadcast.
I will. I got it, Rumpus.
As ta-ta. You can see in the side chat, that we are literally not making these things up. They are literally serious.
Yeah, are you surprised that I knew what the hell you were talking about? See, I don't just pull shit on my ass. I actually am pretty ready.
Are you talking about me too? I mean, like, we literally know exact certain things that a lot of people just never think about.
It's kind of like I have to run my argument one day. I might do it now since Han Solo left, but yeah, I think he's heard it before. I do it with Rumpus because Rumpus knows physics. So hey, you guys care if I run this pseudo argument about how mass doesn't exist? That we're nothing. We're human beings. We're just nothing. Do you guys care?
I'll plug my ears, take my headset off, and run outside.
Get his ass in here, though.
You do it, but go ahead.
I'm going to mute some people because I'm getting a lot of feedback. Okay, Rumpus, you there, buddy?
Yay!
Okay, so, hey, buddy, I love Rumpus. Okay, so,
you don't need to speak.
Here's my pseudo-argument why we don't exist. Why Steve, what?
You don't even speak English.
What do you mean?
I'm playing with you.
Okay, nosotros vivimos en Estados Unidos porque no me gusta hablar español porque es muy difícil para mí, pero es muy importante de mi negocio y mi cliente está bien. Oh, wait, shit, I'm sorry, wrong language. Yeah, I speak Spanish. Oh my God, nobody knew that. A little bit, un poquito. So, here's my argument, Rumpus, why we don't exist. Rumpus. So, would you agree that pretty much most of the interspatial region between atoms is space?
Yep.
Okay. And would you say that's about 99% is what the estimate really is?
Yeah.
Okay. Would you say that between the nucleons and the electrons, it's space, empty space?
Yep.
Okay. Would you agree that inside the nucleons, inside the protons, inside the neutrons, there is a quantum soup going on of just quarks coming in and out, the three of them, but the rest of it is empty space?
You said quarks coming in and out of...
Yeah, you have two up, two, one down, two down, one up, depending on your nucleon.
So I thought you said the quarks were coming in and out of existence. You didn't say that, did you?
Yeah, they do. They come out, they pop in and out where they might be, probabilistically, inside the proton. There's a model you can actually see where they're coming in and out, and there's only three, when you look at them, there's only three that will actually be at any given time, but they do actually pop in and out of the quantum foam, the quantum fluctuations inside the proton.
Oh, I didn't realize the quarks actually disappeared. I knew the mm-hmm. things inside them did. I didn't realize the actual quarks themselves mm-hmm. disappeared.
Quarks and gluons, both. The anti-gluons and the gluons as well.
Yeah, that was okay. I didn't know they actually disappeared. But okay, guess okay. Right, yeah, I'll go with that. Yep.
Okay. So basically, you have a proton, which is this is called a sphere. Okay, a boundary zone. If you want to do it as like a matter.
Yeah.
So inside there, you have nothing except for these quarks, three quarks popping in and out anywhere. And on the outside, you've got nothing until you get to the electron. So you just have a boundary. But a boundary of what? What is that comprised of? So you have nothing between the atoms. You have nothing between the nucleons and the electrons. You have nothing inside the photon except for when these little quarks want to pop in and out. You have no boundary for where the photon exists, where it doesn't exist. You have no boundary for when the atoms exist. So basically, you don't fucking exist. You made up nothing.
Yeah, when you put it like that, there was a lot of nothing going on, wasn't there?
So where am I going wrong in that pseudo argument?
Yeah, it's the electromagnetic force. You kind of missed it out.
Well, actually, it'd be the strong nuclear force, but it's a secondary. The There's a strong nuclear force between the gluon, between the quarks, and that's your carrier, your carriers, your gauge bosons, which are your like for weak nuclear reactions, it's what WZ, and then for your strong nuclear reactions, it's gluons. But that only holds the quarks together inside the nucleon. Yeah. What holds the rest of the nucleons together is what's called a secondary strong nuclear force. It's a residual force that actually holds the nucleons together. That's why you can only have like up to 118 or whatever it is, because after that, it's outside the sphere of influence of the strong nuclear force, because it's only the force inside the protons and neutrons that are actually holding those things together. Although what that means, I don't know, because we just established they don't exist of anything. But anyways,
there is something there though, Steve, isn't there? Those quarks, even those guys. Hold on, so if the quarks are coming in out of existence, so you're saying, right, is there a time when the proton's not actually there then, if the quarks are gone?
That's good. Well, yeah, the probabilistic model, there's a probabilistic model, they don't exist until they somehow manifest at a specific point. And when they done, I don't know if they did resonant imagery. I don't remember the technology they used to do this. I've seen it. And you can actually, they have a graph, and it's a three-dimensional graph, and it actually shows, like, this thing, like, over here coming in and out, and this thing over here coming
out. Yeah, I've seen that. Yeah. I didn't think those were the quarks, though. I thought those were sort of intermediate mass, or I'm not quite sure what they were, actually.
They're the quarks, and actually they've broken it down where the quarks can exist, like, here, 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 and here, and then they get better, they get quark kinesis here and here.
But those pictures were, lots of things were there. It wasn't just three things. I mean, or was it a probability distribution of the quarks?
I don't think it was a probability distribution. I don't think that's what that model was. It was literally a representation of where these things are just coming in and out of existence.
I wanted to look at that picture just the other day, actually. I might go and look at that, actually. I might go and do that online.
But anyways, we can find that another time. But I mean, I thought it was a good argument. It's like, really, you exist of nothing, you know? I think mass is basically just condensed energy. People refer to that, and I think that's a pretty spot on thing. Mass is energy. It's just condensed form of it. That's all it is. I don't think mass has any real substance. People have called me a materialist before. I'm like, no, if anything, I'm probably an anti-materialist. anyways, I thought you'd get a kick out of that.
I would. No, you've got me going a bit there, actually. I'm going to go and look up this
diagram. I'm not as I don't have as much expertise as King Logos has in these things, so I have no idea.
Yeah, well, you're not him. Yeah. Yeah, you don't claim to have expertise, so you can't have it, yeah.
Yeah, exactly. I just claim I don't know shit about anything, and then when I actually make sense on something, like, hey, Steve the idiot made sense on something.
But you do know what Young's modulus is, though, don't you?
Yeah, stress over strain.
Exactly.
I took metallurgy. And he sure the hell didn't. He didn't know what tensile stress was. He didn't know what modulus elasticity. And there's other modulus, too. That Young's modulus is one of them.
You've forgotten. Yeah, there are others, aren't there? Yeah.
Yeah. So, I mean, I studied this stuff in nuke school. We have to take metallurgy as one of the things we have to take, because we have to understand exactly how things warm up, how they heat down. We have to do a process of warming up the nuclear reactor, like the pressurizer vessel. The pressurizer vessel has to be at a certain pressure and temperature. Well, as you know, if you heat something up too quickly and cool it down too quickly, it can brittle fracture. It can harden. The molecular structure actually changes. And so if you do this incorrectly in this process of thermal expansion and starting up the plant, you can have what's called a catastrophic failure. So to understand how metals react with the different things, we had to study, you know, how alloys work, basically how this stuff all kind of works with each other. And for him to claim that he's a structural engineering degree, or no, degree, sorry, structural engineering expertise, would you not agree that that would be something very basic to know?
Yeah, I mean, it just goes to show what slips off his tongue without him ever engaging his brain. I mean, it's just ridiculous. It's so naughty. I mean, but then again, it just demonstrates the complete lack of reliability of anything you can say. I mean, it's what you'd expect, really, isn't it, if you come down to it. It's the sort of thing, given that he believes in a flat earth. I mean, for God's sake, he believes in a flat earth. You know, he's not got any expertise in thinking, let alone bloody structural engineering. Jesus.
Yeah. If you don't have the amount of geometry required to understand the difference between a flat structure and a curved structure, your chances of you getting anywhere as far as structural engineering goes is zilch.
Well, wasn't he okay? Correct me if I'm wrong. Didn't he try to say that a plane had?
Yes.
A plane. We're not talking like a sky plane. We're talking about a plane.
You do wonder sometimes.
I got a plane, right? A plane is a two-dimensional object. Okay, a real plane has no width to or no height to it. Okay, so if you have any things that are going up, any height differentials on it, something like that, it is no longer a plane. It is a three-dimensional thing. So he was trying to say that he thinks the Earth is not a plane. He said, "Well, I never says a plane. It has ups and downs." No, that wasn't an argument. What was his argument? He's arguing that, he thinks it's a plane, but he thinks it's a plane that has ups and downs. We're like, well, that's not a plane then.
can you see this pretty picture?
Yes, that's one of them. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. That's your quark sort of charge distribution, I think, or something. I'm not quite sure exactly what it is, but that's what it. There's some distribution there, and I presume it's the quark thing, but I'm gonna completely check what it is. But it's certainly related to the thing you were describing.
Yeah, let me see if I can find exactly the one I was referring to. So much background noise. I'll go to images. One sec. Yeah, I would have to find it, but you know what I'm talking about.
Yeah.
But I think the argument is still sound. That, because quarks they don't even have any mass to them either ways. They're energetic, but they only have relativistic mass. They have they don't really have any kind of physical mass to it per se.
They don't have any rest mass.
They don't have a rest mass, do they? No, they do.
I think they do. Yeah.
They do. They have to. Yeah, photons don't have rest mass, but.
So if they got a bit of rest mass, I mean, that means, I'm a bit shocked by you telling me they actually disappear. You've got me.
because inside. Inside the nucleon, these quarks basically are like electrons, in a way. You know how electrons, you have a 360 degree sphere, and then you got your orbitals, your sp, d, and stuff. Basically, the electrons appear anywhere that they can be. We predict where they may be. We try to pinpoint, but we only go so far. We can say
the probabilistic distribution.
You have your wave function, then your wave function squared is your probabilistic density. So I think it's a lot on those lines, that it's the same kind of thing, that they don't exactly exist as a probabilistic density to them. But that gets really beyond my capabilities. The fact that I even know what the hell a psi squared probabilistic density is, to me, it still amazes me because I'm an idiot, right? So whatever.
Oh, you don't underestimate yourself, Steve. I think I don't think many people would quite understand know about quantum deflections and I know what a bloody gluon is, for goodness sake. I think you must be in about the top 1 or 2% of the population, I think, to even have a vague understanding about what's going on here.
Oh no, not even close. I mean, this is not complicated stuff. This is a pop science version of it. I'm a pop science version of that kind of stuff because I tried learning Braquette notation and complex conjugates.
You've seen the differential equations. That puts you in the top
1%.
If you took 100 people, how many other people do you think have seen those equations? In less than 1%, I'll bet you.
I don't know. I know a lot of people that are interested in it.
Yeah, but there's a big difference between that.
Well, I've seen them. I didn't get my head wrapped around it, but I've seen them.
How about Einstein's equations? I mean, literally his book of differential equations. Not just his field metric tensor for gravity, but I mean, have you ever seen Einstein's actual full book of equations that's out there? It's ridiculous. And then how about Maxwell's equations? Holy shit!
Yeah, Maxwell equations are not to be messed with. Yeah.
it's nasty shit there, man. You're dealing with integral, triple integrals, and field vectors, and density tensors, and yeah.
Yeah, that's right. As I told you before, I never actually got round to using a tensor in anger. So you've got me on there.
But you understand the concept, right? I mean,
I understand the concept. Yeah. It was about 20 years ago, so I sort of, though I did try and refamiliarize myself with it about 2 years ago. It's basically sort of vector field business, but I haven't
between, there's a big difference between having a vague understanding and remembering that and actually using it in anger, which, whereas I think you've actually used them in anger, haven't you?
No, I haven't. We did not get that into, we stopped at vector analysis for vector fields, so we didn't really have to get into tensor fields that much, because when you're dealing with a neutron flux, it's a vector. I mean, these neutrons, we don't care about the forces so much. We want to know where the neutrons end up. We want to know if the neutron life cycle, if the neutron is being absorbed by the fuel. We want to know if the neutron has leaked out. We want to know if something else has absorbed it, called the non-fuel utilization form factor. So these are just vector things, where the photon is going and the directionality. It's not what a tensor is you have a field that you have a point. You have an x, y, and z vector on that point that's causing different magnitudes. So that's a little more complicated. It'd be useful, like deformation. If I got a square or something like that, and there's a field, how it may distort, you know, because it might be a different force in the x than in the y, so it's going to deform. But that doesn't really apply when it comes to neutron flux densities. That I did in anger. I had to know neutron flux densities in anger.
Right. Okay. I never had to do this stuff in anger. Whereas you actually had to do. You know. You actually became intimate with these things. Whereas I never did actually become intimate.
Yeah. I almost asked the neutron to marry me, but the bitch said no.
Oh well, you have to move on to quarks then, or something.
Lower my standards to quarks. Hey Max, by the way, I saw you come in. I didn't mean to ignore you. We were just shooting the shit.
So, unfortunately, I missed. Sorry, Steve. I missed. By the way, you're not actually subscribed to my right account, so I missed you. You're subscribed to my umbrella account and not my other one.
I think you mentioned that before too, and I thought I'd fix that. Okay, let me do that right now while you guys.
So I keep on missing some of your points. When you invite me or anything, but yeah, I'm mostly following you on your one, so I get that. But
that shouldn't be. That's no fun.
I saw that you missed my FM3. I saw you lose a comp.
Oh damn! Yeah, I'd love to have seen that. Oh well.
I'll look at it shortly.
I've added you right now. Well, no, it says you follow. I said I'm following you.
Okay, all right then. Perhaps I'm good.
Oh, I've added you to the circles though. So.
Yeah. Okay.
I'm putting you in all my circles. I put you in all six of them, which I don't do.
Oh, good.
I don't know what the hell the difference they mean, but you're now in six of my circles. So.
Yeah, and I have different circles for people I want to get emails from. So, for instance, if you post something, I actually get an email from you. Whereas other people, I just get that in some of my feeds. So you can vary what the different circles do, and it can be quite useful.
Oh, I'm kind of bummed. I was saving that six circle thing because I never put anybody in six circles. I was saving it for some hot chick that had a nice blonde that would come in here, or somebody I maybe had.
Were there any blondes on your nuclear physics thing? Your military nuclear?
No, actually, what's funny, when I was there, girls, sexist here, girls could not join. They were banned from it. Yeah, they did. It wasn't like 10 years later they were accepted to the new program.
Yeah, so, my physics degree, we only had about 8% women on ours on our course.
I think the reasoning was because
that's actually not surprising. A lot of women don't actually. It seems like a lot of women aren't really interested. They either think that they can't join in, or they just don't want to deal with the course load and wander off.
Hang on. I want to clarify here. It wasn't the technical stuff the reason why women couldn't join, okay? The reason why women couldn't join when I was in is because they hadn't. I don't think they want to take the chance of the radiological exposure to reproductive things for women.
Actually,
especially if they were pregnant, because we worked right next to the secondary shielding. Literally, we were exposed to neutron radiation, which is 20 times worse than most radiation. If you look at the biological equivalency, man. There's a huge difference between neutron radiation and then like beta radiation. I will suck on beta radiation. It's pretty harmless.
Yeah.
But a neutron will fuck your life up. So yeah. I think that was the reason, because of the reproductive aspect that they didn't.
That's because they're heavy. Anyway, what I was going to say is that the other reason they didn't let women into the nuke field was that women weren't allowed on combat vessels until 2000.
That might be some truth to that as well.
There would have to be no place that I know of that the Navy where the Navy goes or does things as a nuclear reactor unless it is required in combat. Carriers, some of your other larger vessels sometimes have nuclear reactors, but the vast majority of tenders won't. And that's where you're going to find most of the women any damn way.
Yeah, you won't find someone who qualified the new program tender because it's so costly to train them. Right now, the people are getting $100,000 for 2 years of enlistment bonus, which is unheard of. This highest in any military. Was a machinist mate, was a nuclear machinist mate. People that actually worked on the radiological aspect of the reactor system, and then I supervised it. So yeah, it's for $100,000, I would have stayed in. I think. Nobody gets.
They didn't offer you $30,000 when you got out.
They offered me $30,000 tax free, but now it's $100,000.
Well, they're still not gonna. They still didn't offer. They offered you $30,000. I don't know where I came up with $30,000. I'm not even sure I said $30,000. They didn't offer you $100,000. You just stayed.
Yeah. No, they didn't. No, but they didn't
probably offer would have paid off your house.
Yeah. Well, I sold my house, so it doesn't matter. But yeah, no. I mean, $100,000. So they want these people to stay because. It's so hard to train them when you have 67% attrition rate, and then people do get out after 6 years. It's worse than the SEAL program. It is literally the academic version of the SEALs. I always say that over and over again. It's hard.
Is it? Did they actually manage to get it down to 67? It was closer to 80 that I recall.
Well, my class was 67, so that's all I can go by. It was around that. It was not
I know they were sending nuke ETs out to the ships if they managed to get through BEE.
Yeah, there was a scandal. Well, there was a scandal a while back. I guess there was a cheating scandal in the 2000s or something where they were so hard that the instructors felt pressured to actually give them the answers to the test prior to the test.
Your buddy would be right.
It was like 20 people.
If you captain a nuclear vessel, you would have to become an officer, and that means usually means going to Annapolis, and you have to have a high school diploma to get there.
Yeah, the nuke program, you have to have at least a GED. You have to have at least, I think, an 80 on the ASVAB. I got a 99, which is the highest possible on the ASVAB. My FQT was 99. Nobody else I know has ever scored that high.
I scored 98.
I remember you told me that before, and I know two or three people got 98. That's brilliant, dude. I mean, you are.
I went to boot camp with five guys that all scored 99.
Yeah, the CIA did a little chart. I think it was for the CIA, but it was anything over like 90, 95, I think, was equivalent to 145 IQ and higher. So, anyways, I want to show you guys something. Go ahead and chat real quick. I'm going to give you guys some mods. I'll be back in less than 3 minutes. Kage, Rumpus, you guys have control.
I already have controls in here. I found that out a while ago.
Yeah, so I'm gonna be back in like a few minutes. Like 30. Yeah, about 2 minutes. So I want to show you something.
Okay, see, Steve.
Oh, but yeah, nuke the nuke. I saw some. I gotta look at some of the materials for the nuke school. I just went. No, we're not gonna do that.
So you're saying you've been in a nuclear sub then or something? Is that you saying?
I have not been on a nuclear sub. In fact, I absolutely 110% failed the psych test to do that. I spent some time on carriers.
Oh right, with a nuclear reactor.
Okay. I have never done this before. Okay, this is the first time I've done. I'm going to do this. Okay, this is my little. And it's not even that complete. I put this one together just recently because I'm job hunting. But okay, just to give you guys a little verification that I'm not pulling shit out of my ass, and I don't feel like I need to do this for any other reason because I want to because I know you guys believe me. But this is my ship. Okay,
the USS Truxton. Oh, the Truxton.
Huh, Carl Vinson.
The Truxton. I know her.
Okay, so this is right here. And anybody can make anything up, but I don't know if you can see it. But this is Naval Nuclear Power School. This is my. Certificate of completion. I used to have it all framed and everything, but the thing broke, so I just took all these out. So this, you can see mine. Can you see my name?
I can see your name.
Okay, so I mean, this.
Roger.
This is legit. This is that I did go to college.
Actually, let me look at the signature there.
Oh, that was Captain Con. No, that Jensen. I think that was Jensen.
Yeah, that would be Jensen's signature.
Okay, so
I've seen that a few times.
Yeah, so This, and this is my, you know, certificate of academic achievement. Look at, what does it say, that Dean's List 4.0 college?
Yeah.
Okay, so that's that. And I did, and it's the, I have this too, my good Gothic medal. Yeah. But I also have an armed services expeditionary medal. That means I actually get a veteran of foreign wars. I'm a VFW, which, because if you get an expeditionary medal, it qualifies you for that, because you served in wartime in a foreign area. Now we're off the coast of Kuwait. So anyway, so now that, I mean, like I said, I don't feel like I have it to validate, but just so if it ever gets brought up to anybody. I do have my documentations to prove that I did graduate and move to PowerScope. If you want to see my DG214, I have that as well. So, anyways.
You've got nothing to prove, Steve.
I know. I felt like, you know, at least it has to be recorded at some point. So, yeah, whatever.
Yeah, but we can hear, you know what? Honestly, we can hear you talking. So, yeah. we know that you have, you get concepts that some of us don't. I mean, I can run my way around a radar unit, but don't turn me loose in a reactor. I'd probably screw it up.
You know what's funny though? I, to date, the people talk a lot of shit, but I've never been challenged on my military background. I'm kind of surprised.
Military background is easy enough to prove if you've got somebody's actual name.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, I will admit I looked.
I knew when you told me
when you were there, and I had your name. I had your name anyway, so I went and I took a peek.
Yeah, I mean, you can go to the Truxton webpage too. I'm on there. Did you see what my nickname was?
I didn't. I didn't even look at the Truxton page. I'm sorry. I went and looked up the details for the nuke school for the time period you were going to be there. I wasn't sure which ship you'd been on or where or when, so.
Class of 8088 was my class.
Yeah. So. But I didn't go to Orlando until 93, so.
And yes, I was honorably discharged. I have all that shit. Anyways, Jake, my love, now that you came in here, did you want to add anything? I mean, I need to go back and rehash like the prior hangout and what we were talking about earlier, but. Since you were involved in that, does anything you want to add? Did you watch what I have to say about dishonesty? We'll wait for Jade for a second.
Yeah, I've missed that, Steve. Yeah, so I'm looking forward to having you having a good go at Niffy.
Well, I mean, it was kind of funny because I'm like, damn, Niffy, can you rewrite history any more than you did? It was really
I saw you having a debate with someone saying it wasn't a good idea to go in. Or I can't remember now whether I heard this or read this. Someone was telling you, you said you regretted going in or something. So it wasn't a good idea or something. And you...
Yeah, I got talked into it. I was in a hangout with Keithies, and I guess they said Neff was in a hangout. Do you guys want to go over there? And I explained to them, no, I don't go into Neff's room unless I absolutely have to. Like, I think one time I went in there to talk to Tommy, and we had, you know, 5-minute discussion. But other than that, I don't go in his room because he just moots and boots. I've learned that over the... You know, the time I've been on Google Plus, he just mutes you and then boots you. And of course, he never gave me more than 10 seconds to say anything.
Yeah. If you're trying to say something complicated, it's really annoying, isn't it? When you're trying to say something complicated, you need more than about 30 seconds to get it over. And if you're interrupted in that phase, I was speaking to Matt, I was on Matt Slick's show last night, and there I had the same problem. I was trying to get over this concept of probabilistic things and uncaused events, etc. And when they only give you 10 seconds before they start getting impatient with you, it really wrecks your ability to explain things.
Yeah.
And if
never,
it's booting. Yeah. So.
It's horrible at that. And so, anyways, but to make a long story short, you know, when he kicked Jade for being having hearing difficulties, I got upset. But he made so many lies, it was just ridiculous. And I was saying, oh, I never gave him evidence. Well, sure, I gave him a lot of evidence. And then the fact that what evidence we gave to him, he didn't know how to read, right? Jay and I were literally laughing our ass off at how badly his understanding was of this stuff.
So when was this hangout? Was that early today?
Oh, no. This was several days ago.
This is the one when he slagged Jade off for not being able to hear properly.
Yeah. Right, but he made a video about it this morning. He was in a hangout with True and G-Man, and he basically said, I was scared of him, I ran away, he challenged me to a debate, and, you know, I'm like, well, yeah, and I accepted until you said you weren't going to use scientific terms, and then I said, you know what, forget it, I'm never going to debate you now.
So it's on Neff's channel, is it, this video?
Yeah.
Right, okay.
Yeah. But I mean, Jay was there. I mean, Jay, did I not say specifically, fine, I'll debate you, but you have to use scientific terms? He said no. And did I not leave because you were kicked and had nothing to do with the fact that we were not presenting him evidence because you gave him perfect evidence, correct?
Still no, Jade. She's still having a mic check, I think.
No, I just heard her. Okay, it's weird because sometimes Jade never shuts up and other times you can never
hear her. Yeah, you can't shut her up, can you? It's always one thing or the other.
Maybe she's talking right now, but we just can't hear her.
Maybe all of us are talking, we just can't hear each other. Maybe, you know, who knows?
She says she's got to get. She says she's going and coming right back.
I demonstrated earlier that we don't really exist. We don't have no.
Jade will be returning momentarily, apparently.
Oh, I gotta check the live feed. Shit, I haven't checked the chat for a while. My bad, guys.
Yeah,
oh, just Stack Bundles. This guy's funny. Stack Bundles, aka I Love Jesus, aka Target. I'm pretty sure it's the same guy. He just sits in these freaking side chats. Usually Nadia's channel just doing the side chats all day long. It's weird. But hey, I'm glad to have you over here, Stack, since you're usually over in Nadia's just chatting away, saying, you know.
So what scientific terms doesn't Neff want to use?
I don't know. Dude, this is okay. Here's my reasoning out here. Okay, about this. Okay, if we did, let's say, like we did Macro Evolution, like I did with Wayne, right? Which I wouldn't do again, but if I were to pick that topic, the whole thing is I only have to give an argument to demonstrate to the people listening. Okay, I have to convince the audience. I have to convince that there's a scientific thing for this stuff, right? I mean, to show them the science behind it and say this is why it is. That's not that difficult to do with evolution. I mean, it's pretty actually easy because we know as rational human beings that evolution exists, and we know that there's overwhelming evidence for it. We can go read and say, okay, I'm reading this, the study, whatever, it demonstrates evolution. But what they got to do is they have to redefine what these words mean and say, oh, no, that's not evolution. That's variation. That's normal reproduction. That's not evolution.
Yeah, and of course with Tommy, of course, the only thing he's going to accept is evolution. If you can actually go and find the bit of the DNA in the genome that actually causes the mutation, you've got to go and find exactly the little bit of DNA that actually causes the feature that he's interested in, which is incredibly difficult to do. We still don't know. I mean, we've got the genome, human genome, but we don't know what bits of it are doing and what goes where. And even with presumably things like Drosophila or something, do we know what those bits, all the bits of the DNA in Drosophila do?
No, Jade likes to say the hunt and poke method. They're basically poking these Hox genes and seeing what happens.
Yeah, that's right.
And I did stuff like that when I was in computer programming. I had a game, like I remember one game called Eye of the Beholder. It was a dungeon crawl. And what I would do is I would, you know, print out memory locations. And you know hexadecimal because you know computers. So
yeah.
You have your offset, and then you have, you know, your hex locations. You remember your hex numbers in your location, memory location. And I just sit there and change the hex values and see how it affects the game.
Right.
and I did other things too. I put it through soft ice or something, and I would look at the actual kind of code. But anyways, I would take a snapshot of a game, and then I would, like, spend money or something, and I'd take another snapshot and see the differences. I'd do a comparison between the two. And I was able to isolate what locations had the registry functions for, you know, like AX and whatever, for the amount of gold. And so I said, if I just change this hexadecimal number here, it'll change how much gold I have. And that's how I crack games. Back old school, before nowadays, people say the crackers, all they do is download a patch, right?
Yeah.
But that's the hunt method. That's this, you know, you poke it and you see what it does and what changes. That's what they do with these Hox genes.
Yeah, I used to use a disassembler. I must admit, that's a bit radical, fiddling with the hex. I used to use disassemblers and then do that. But actually, just fiddling with the hex, that's really
sucky.
Basic.
Sucky. low level as you can get, man.
That's really hardcore, that one, yeah.
But again, this is back in the day where you didn't have the option to go download a hack or crack or a patch for something. This was back in the early 90s, early 90s.
Yeah, I mean, I used to do my disassembling hacking in the late 80s.
I remember you were asked to go into, you can go into Apple IIe and you type in debug. Yeah, so you just you have like hex stuff comes up.
Anyway, yeah, well, I mean, we're I had a BBC computer, which probably you haven't heard of over there, but that was a sort of had BBC Basic, which actually Bill Gates nearly bought actually to put on the on his PC. It was very nearly the PC's MS-DOS had BBC Basic.
They licensed, they initially licensed and then forced the guy out of a thing called QuickDOS. The guy actually still lives up here in Bellevue, and he's pissed. He's still pissed about it.
Let's try to get Jade in here. I got to wrap this up pretty soon.
Okay.
Jade, do you want to add anything?
No, not really. You can hear me okay now, yes. Right? Yeah. Okay, I got that fixed. Yeah.
I got you 5x5.
I'm
reading you. Go ahead.
I didn't hear, you know, like everything you said, but I heard like the beginning of your hangout there, and yeah, it's just Nev. Neff is delusional. He creates his own little world, and he lives in it happily. You know, he's like some, you know, little old man who putters around in his garden of idiocy, and, you know, he grows his little fake plants, you know, that he's invented. That, you know, it's really nothing but a bunch of empty pots, you know, sitting there, but he sees beautiful flowers in each one of those empty pots, and it's just all his imagination. That's it. His little garden of his imagination.
Are you getting anywhere with those ball and socket joints in fish, Jade?
Leave it to a botanist to use a botanist reference. Go figure. Right? but I mean, would you concur though that I mean, in that particular hangout he was referring to, one, how he treated you was disrespectful, and two, that what else could we present to him? I mean. He kept saying in this video we never presented him evidence, which is absurd. And did you also notice that, again, not to bring up too much, but he keeps calling me an atheist.
Yeah, I noticed that. And you said many, many times to everyone that you're not an atheist. I've heard it. I can't tell you how many times you're not an atheist.
Yeah, but I bet you can't remember what Steve actually is, because I can never remember.
I don't care. You know, but yeah, we gave him exactly what he wanted.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that paper you presented was spot. How much more perfect could you get? But the paper you presented was it was on moths and butterflies and the segmentation of the Hawk chains and how they express.
Yes, exactly. It was it was the difference between flies and butterflies.
Flies and butterflies, yeah.
Right, and the difference in their wing, and they traced it to the Hawk chain. Mm-hmm. How the you know if you look at a butterfly wing and you look at the fly wing and they're different. They know how that happened. They've got the down to the Hawks gene, how that happened.
Wow.
And, you know, what more could he want it? And then he said, when we gave it to him, oh, do you remember he kept confusing two separate things? He kept saying, well, that's not evidence of a new structure. And I said, well, no, you didn't ask for a new structure. You asked for a, I can't think of the right phrase, but an alteration in a, you know, a new...
Modifications.
Thank you. You asked for a modification and could show us the genetics of a modification. I showed you that. And he kept saying, well, that's not a new structure. He kept confusing the two.
Here's the thing. It's funny. What we gave him evidence was for evolution. What we gave him was for science. I mean, we may technically not have given him what he asked for, and for the fact what he asked for doesn't exist because...
Right.
Right. It's not science. It's not evolution. So it's a disconnect there because what he's thinking is evolution. If we would actually have evidence for that, it would disprove evolution.
Mm-hmm.
And he doesn't grasp this basic fucking concepts. His version is wrong. His version is not what's taught anywhere. He just makes up this shit and says, oh, evolution must do this, this, and this. No, Nephi. No. As Fiona would say,
he's not going to be asking for dog, a non-dog from a dog or something next, is he?
Nope,
he's asking for a crocoduck.
Yeah, exactly.
Why didn't you go back to Spriginia? That's about 600 million years ago. That's the first ever worm after multicellular life.
I'm gonna go ahead and
tetrapods were not there. They came after.
Yeah, I've got to end this, guys.
Fire.
Yeah, Creator, I got to end this. So, anyways, guys, thank you very much for the support you guys have been giving me.
Okay.
I do appreciate it immensely. I mean, not that Nephilim needs to be rebuked or you know why it's even required for us to even to have this kind of hangout to explain to people why Nephi Fu was so wrong. But I think it's enjoyable. I get a kick out of it because we know he's wrong.
Don't regret it. Yeah, don't regret it, Steve. Don't regret it.
Yeah, I get a kick out of it. To me, I'm flattered that Nephi takes the time to make this shit up about me.
Yeah, exactly.
You know?
So means you're taking notice of you. If there's something worse than being ignored, it's not being ignored.
Yeah, amen, brother, right? So I'm gonna take off for a while. I'll be back later on. But guys, again, appreciate it very much, and we will see you guys later.